Good morning, Good Shepherd. Please join me in this call to worship. Your response will be on the screen. With great rejoicing, we come to the house of the Lord today. God is our refuge and our stronghold. The power and love of God flow through this gathering. We place our whole trust in God's mighty compassion for us. Come, let us worship the Lord. Let us celebrate the presence of God here in this place and in all our lives. Amen.
Sometimes I see a hummingbird or a rainbow paint the sky. Or I hear a baby's cry. Miracles, there are miracles. So quietly, a voice is heard, like a gentle lullaby. And I know exactly why. Miracles, there are miracles. Sometimes the little things are so hard to see, and good things hard to do. But I know in this great big world that you will see me. Please bring me closer. Thankfully, there is a word when reason won't apply. All the things that mystify, miracles, they are miracles. Sometimes the little things are so hard to see, and good things hard to do. But I know in this great big world that you will see me. Please bring me closer. When I'm at sea, when I'm deterred, in my heart I know that I will be with you by and by. Lord, help me to love and be aware that miracles come through faith and prayer. I won't take you for granted. All these his miracles. Wondrous miracles, and they are everywhere.
This is my father's world, and to my listening ears, all nature sings, and round me rings the music of the spheres. This is my father's seas, his hands the wonders wrought. This is my father's world. The birds their carols raise, the morning light, the lily white, declare their
A reading from Psalm 69. Save me, O God, for the waters have come up to my neck. I sink in the miry depths where there is no foothold. I have come into deep waters. The floods engulf me. I am worn out, calling for help. My throat is parched. My eyes fail, looking for my God. Those who hate me without reason outnumber the hairs on my head. Many are my enemies without cause. Those who seek to destroy me, I am forced to restore what I did not steal. But I pray to you, Lord, in the time of your favor, in your great love, O God, answer me with your sure salvation.
I know there is a place for me. Help me to grow that I may live and see. A stream that flows, a well no end to find, that holds fills my chattering mind. I know there is a home inside, window to soul, where every dream abides. Each breath is gold, a pathway light, a guide, garden to grow, keep on the sunny side. Some call it prayer, some say it should.
Story. All are welcome at the table of God.
Every human is God's child.
For Christ brings peace to all,
tearing down every hostile wall,
so that the many may become one.
One heart.
One family.
One new humanity.
For God, who is love.
And Christ, who is all and in all.
Show no partiality and make no distinction.
So neither race nor class,
gender nor sexuality,
politics nor religion,
personality nor nationality,
count for us or against us.
The light of Christ enlightens all.
Christ the prisoner and the naked.
Christ the hungry and the sick.
Christ the thirsty and the stranger.
Christ the other.
May God's Spirit hover over our chaos,
our hatred and our indifference.
Descend in our hearts with love and pleasure.
Blow us out into the world to listen and to serve.
And set us ablaze to forgive and reconcile.
For all are welcome at the table of God.
Every human is God's child.
Earth whirling through space, a human race created from the dust of dying stars. Feel tectonic plates shifting their weight, holding all our hopes and dreams above. Out into a distant void, light curling through space at an infinite pace, cutting past like ships upon a sea.
Song, earth's melody. sweetest moment in love eternally.
My name is Jennifer from Maine. Please join us in our generosity prayer. Godliness with contentment is great gain. We bring nothing into this world and we take nothing out of it. We who call Jesus Lord devote ourselves to resisting greed, which plunges the human heart into ruin and pierces it with many griefs. We are determined to practice generosity with free hearts, fixing our hope on God and not the uncertainty of wealth. We desire to be rich in good deeds, willing to share all that we have, laying up for ourselves treasure that will not decay, but will shine in the age to come. May this be true of our community. Amen. At this time, we invite you to share the gift of your blessing with those with you or those afar, with grace and peace. Text or call a loved one. Grace and peace to you.
Corinthians 12:12 through 27. For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For by one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and all were made to drink of one Spirit. For the body does not consist of one member, but of many. If the foot should say, "Because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body," that would not make it any less a part of the body. And if the ear should say, "Because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body," well, that would not make it any less a part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would be the hearing? If the whole body were an ear, where would be the sense of smell? But as it is, God arranged the organs in the body, each one of them, as he chose. If all were a single organ, where would the body be? As it is, there are many parts, yet one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, "I have no need of you," nor again the head to the feet, "I have no need of you." On the contrary, the parts of the body which seem to be weaker are indispensable, and those parts of the body which we think less honorable, we invest with the greater honor. And our unpresentable parts are treated with greater modesty, which our more presentable parts do not require. But God has so composed the body, giving the greater honor to the inferior part, that there may be no discord in the body, but that the members may have the same care for one another. If one member suffers, all suffer together. If one member is honored, all rejoice together. Now, you are the body of Christ, and individually members of it. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
What did you think church was when you were growing up? When you were a child, if someone asked you what church was, what it was for, what it was about, what its purpose was, what would you have said? For those people who were raised in non-religious families, perhaps churches were places of mystery. You didn't really know what went on inside of these places, but you were happy you didn't have to wake up early on Sunday mornings to find out. For many of you who grew up in culturally religious families, churches were merely places of tradition. You visited them on holidays when the family was all together, singing a few carols or hymns before hitting up the Golden Corral. Maybe you grew up in a devout Catholic family, or you came from a more liturgical Protestant tradition, and for you, church might have been a place of ritual. There were robes and recitations, even incense, all of which might have felt rote or boring to a squirmy youngster, but at least every week was the same. Now, I was raised in a more evangelical tradition, so for me, if you had asked me, I would have said that church was a place of belief. You see, in my mind, it was kind of like school, except instead of learning about history and math, you went to church to learn about what you believed about God, about the Bible, about the afterlife, about what it meant to be good or holy. From all I could tell, this seemed to be a faith community's primary, if not exclusive, function, and nearly everything my church did seemed to back up the idea. We had Bible studies for adults and Sunday school for kids. The pastor's sermons often felt like college lectures, crafted more to fill the head with specific facts rather than to stir the heart with sacred questions. As a teenager, my church had us memorize scores of Bible verses, and occasionally they even drilled us to see which of us could recall and recite scripture the fastest. By the time I reached college age, My church's small group was even studying something called apologetics, which is not actually the art of saying you're sorry, but rather the discipline of defending what you believe and learning how to convince others to believe those beliefs too. Looking back on my religious upbringing, I feel grateful for many gifts that it bestowed. For example, the litany of Bible verses that are now hidden in my heart that served me on more than a few occasions, often coming to me at just the right moment. But as I've gotten older, I've also recognized the downsides to thinking about church primarily as a kind of belief school. When a church's job is to teach people what to believe, for example, then your place in that community may be dependent on your conformity to the church's sanctioned set of beliefs. And anyone with enough courage to express serious doubts or challenge these beliefs, well, they may find themselves labeled as a nuisance or a heretic, pushed out by the powers that be to the outer darkness. Some of you may know all too well what I'm talking about. Additionally, if a faith community is basically just a belief school, well, then there's less incentive to become a part of one. You see, the digital information age and its many advancements have democratized learning. We live in a time when I can watch TED Talks by leading experts with better oratory skills than most preachers without ever having to get out of my bed. If I'm curious about a particular religious topic, well, I can stream a podcast. I can order a stack of books with the click of a button. I can even have them dropped at my doorstep with 2-day shipping for nothing at all. Thank you very much, Mr. Bezos. If church is nothing more than a belief school, if all of the effort it takes to get here and all of the effort the many volunteers put into making today happen was just for the purpose of creating a place to learn what to believe, well then, I'm not sure it's worth the hassle. But what if a church is more than that? What if a faith community like this one is not just a space to explore what to believe, but a people with whom to explore how to belong? You can see the shift. If that's true, well then a community like this one is one of the most important things in the world today. If that's true, then it's something none of us can afford to live without. In the first century AD, about 50 miles west of Athens, perched above a gulf on the Mediterranean Sea, was a bustling city called Corinth. And in the middle of this urban center was a Christian community that has come to be known as the Church at Corinth. It makes sense. At its best, this community would have been a place of comfort for early practitioners of a budding and largely misunderstood faith being called Christianity. But instead, the church at Corinth had become a place of contention. You see, Corinth was one of the most culturally diverse cities in antiquity. It was a Greek city, but it had been a Roman colony for a century or more. There was great economic diversity there. Ultra wealthy 1%ers lived alongside the great unwashed masses. It was also a popular stop for traveling merchants and seafarers, which means it attracted a range of people from a range of cultures with a range of perspectives on life and faith. But rather than become a melting pot of ideas and identities, this community had become a powder keg of difference. There were disagreements about sex and gender. There were debates about divorce and remarriage. There were contentious discussions about how various spiritual gifts were valuable. Additionally, partisanship was a standard feature of ancient Greco-Roman life. So there was this clash of beliefs and ideas around politics and societies in this church, which had divided into factions led by rival thinkers. One could seem to get along with another, perhaps, but it was often contentious, which is to say their church was not so unlike most of ours. The rifts had grown wide and deep, and the community was now pulling apart at the seams. Before she died, Mother Teresa of Calcutta reflected on the divisions and strife and wars that permeated her world. that were tearing it apart. And Mother Teresa said, if we have no peace, it is because we have forgotten that we belong to each other. In her world, in our world, in the world of ancient Corinth, we're always tempted to forget that we belong to each other. Now, the Apostle Paul had helped plant this church in Corinth, so he had a vested interest in its endurance, in its survival. So Paul becomes pen pals with the people in an effort to help them hold it all together. Now, for all of you blue ribbon Bible drillers out there, you might be surprised to learn that no one has ever actually read 1 Corinthians. You see, Paul's initial letter to Corinth, written in the fall of AD 50, was lost, so we don't know what it said, but apparently the Corinthians pushed back hard with a list of questions for clarification. And then in the spring of AD 51, Paul penned a long reply back, a letter that we now know by the misnomer of 1 Corinthians. And in the 12th chapter of this letter, Paul tries to remind the Corinthian church that amid all of their diversity and differences and disagreements, they belong to each other. And to help them understand exactly what he means, exactly how this works, Paul uses this fleshy metaphor of a human body. For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. Now, when Paul decides to compare the church to a human body, he paints a picture that anyone can recognize, so relatable and understandable that his explanation is almost, well, unnecessary. No one has to convince you that in order to rotate a soup ladle or throw a baseball, you don't just need an arm, but a hand. And if that hand lacks fingers, well, the whole thing falls apart. If you want to run a marathon, having legs and feet are a good start, but you'll need a brain to make them work and eyes to make sure you don't run into a ditch. You see, all of us born into these mysterious meat suits develop an understanding of how all the parts that make it come together into a functioning whole. But what Paul is saying here is that what is true of you is true of us too. We need each other. We rely on each other. We belong to each other. In 1943, an American psychologist named Abraham Maslow published a paper in an American journal that attempted to describe the universal pattern of human motivations. He essentially ranked the most fundamental human needs and ordered them into a pyramid that has become famously known as Maslow's hierarchy of needs. Maslow observed that the human need for belonging ranked third, just under survival and safety. In the many decades since Maslow published his paper, psychological research on this topic has consistently shown that humans universally desire connection and belonging. We crave to be accepted and included into a community. It's a primal human desire, and it has been universally witnessed in all cultures throughout all of human history. You see, buried deep in the center of every human heart is a longing for belonging. And Paul is reminding us that a faith community is actually a divine gift, fashioned by the one who has fashioned us, designed to meet one of our deepest human longings to belong. But we humans are a paradox. We often resist what we most desire. The aspiring writer who sits down to give birth to their novel and then talks themselves out of it. The white knuckled dieter who somehow always ends up bringing junk food back home and binging it after sundown on Saturday. The hopeless romantic with a pattern for ghosting suitors just as intimacy begins to coalesce. The eager exerciser who joins a gym in January and then quietly cancels it in June. Some of you recognize that one. And so it is with belonging, you see. We often resist it even as we long for it. We want to connect, we want community, we want to be known, but then when we start to enter into it, we're strangely tempted to talk ourselves out of it. We tell ourselves we aren't needed or wanted, that we aren't enough like everybody else, that we won't fit in or we don't fit in or we will never fit in. Paul's words, "For the body does not consist of one member, but of many. If the foot should say, 'Because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body,' well, that would not make it any less a hand. And if the ear should say, 'Because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body,' that would not make it any less a part of the body." You see, here is where we begin to learn some really important things about belonging in the body of Christ. First, belonging is not something you earn or create. It's something you've already been given. This is important. You belong because God has already chosen, verse 18, to include you. So you already belong to the body. Belonging is yours, but in order to experience it, you have to yield to it. You have to open yourself up to it. You have to consent to belonging. Now, that can be really difficult for some of us, not just because we think so highly of others, but because we think so lowly of ourselves. As Brené Brown has said in her book, Atlas of the Heart, because we can feel belonging only if we have the courage to share our most authentic selves with people, our sense of belonging can never be greater than our level of self-acceptance. I bet many of you have had an experience like this. You show up in a church because, well, you long to belong. And then, a few minutes into it, you're talking yourself out of it. You look around and suddenly you feel so out of place. You've lost count at the number of unfamiliar faces, and everybody seems to be better dressed than you are. You don't know most of the songs, and the speaker is using all kinds of words you don't understand. And worst of all, everyone else seems to have some kind of skill you lack. You can't sing like Becky, and you're not as extroverted as Bill. And unlike all the people volunteering down in the children's ministry, you hate being around snotty-faced prepubescents. "I don't belong," you say. Oh, but you do. Because inclusion into God's family is not based on feeling, and it's not based on function, and it's not based on fitting in. You are a part of the body, of this body, because you, like everyone else in this community, whether physical or digital, were made by God. And you, like everyone else in this community, whether physical or digital, are the object of God's obsessive love. And you have so much to give, whether you know it or not. There's no one on this earth who is like you. And the gifts that you can give to this community cannot be given by another gift giver, because every gift giver has their own unique gifts to give. This community wouldn't be the same without you. You know, one of the most interesting things about bodies, both the bodies that we live in and the bodies we make together, is how some of the most important parts are some of the least noticed. Those two bean-shaped kidneys in your back, they function every single day without drawing much attention to themselves. But if your kidneys suddenly decided to quit because they didn't feel like they fit in, well, where would that leave the body? When most of us say our evening prayers, we don't thank God for our livers, but we're grateful that they keep us alive. Similarly, you probably don't know the name of the person who said hello to you on the front door or at the front door or appeared in the slide before this one. You don't know the name of the people who will clean this room or who are editing the video that you're watching. The person who smiled your way during that last song. But these are just some of the people who keep this body alive. The thing this community needs most is for you to be you. You see, belonging never asks that you change who you are. It gives you permission to embrace who you are. But the decision is yours. You get to choose whether you want to consent to belonging, which means choosing to show up as your fullest, truest self, not pretending or projecting or people-pleasing. But now a caution. The moment you decide to yield to this belonging that is already yours, oh, things will get complicated and uncomfortable. You see, the reason you decided to join a faith community in the first place was to find friendship and connection and closeness and support and encouragement and inspiration. And instead, you found yourself stuck with a bunch of people who always seem to rub you the wrong way. There's the annoying chatterbox who always seems to find the seat right next to yours or say just the wrong thing. There's the prying person who always asks too many personal questions and can't take a hint. There's the person in your small group, your community group, your regional group through digital church who annoys you to no end. There's the self-righteous person who always volunteers to pray and whose prayers make your skin crawl. And there's the person who says insensitive or arrogant or offensive things that make you want to commit homicide. Well, congratulations. You found the belonging for which you were longing, but you've also found a whole bunch of people who are rude and insensitive and drive you up the stained glass walls. So now what? The Quaker mystic Parker Palmer, in his book The Company of Strangers, defines community as this. He says it's that place where the person you least want to live with always lives. And even if you can find a way to get rid of that person, Palmer says, somebody else inevitably shows up to take their place. Belonging challenges our comfortability and routines and preconceptions by forcing us to live alongside people that we might never choose to live alongside, which is a feature, not a bug. It reveals all sorts of things about us that we'd never notice otherwise. When we're confronted with people's sharp edges, grinding personalities, and confounding views, we start to feel confused or irritated, even angry. But buried beneath all of that emotion and agitation is actually a belief that we would be better if all of you were more like me. If you just thought more like me, voted more like me, behaved more like me, well, then this community would be so much more enjoyable. So Paul extends his metaphor here to show us just how ridiculous these hidden beliefs are in practice. He says, imagine if the body were just eyeballs, or if it were all just ears. He says in the text, if all were a single organ, in verse 19, where would the body be? You don't need to ace a college anatomy class to realize that in order for our body to be whole and healthy, every part needs to be wholly itself. He goes on to say, if the whole body were an eye, where would be the hearing? If the whole body were an ear, where would be the sense of smell? But as it is, God has arranged the organs in the body, each one of them as God chose. If all were a single organ, where would the body be, Paul says. Well, you see here, if a group requires you to change who you are in order to belong, that's a cult. If you require others in a group to change who they are, that's codependency. But a group in which all people are free to be their true selves in interdependence with each other, that is a community. You see, belonging is multi-directional. Not only do you need to allow yourself to belong to others, but you need to allow others to belong to you. So you offer your fullest and truest self to the community, and you allow others in the community to do the same. So Paul here is trying to persuade us, in the words of writer Barbara Brown Taylor, that what is true inside of your own skin is also true outside of it. That wholeness is a matter of many different parts being themselves, that unity and diversity are not contradictory terms, and that our survival depends not on our sameness, but on our infinite variety. Taylor adds, "Now that is fine when it is my liver or my kneecaps you're talking about. I rejoice in the difference between them, and I would not want either of them trying to do the other's job. The problem begins when you put me in a community with a bunch of people who look, smell, think, talk, and act differently from me because I do not handle the infinite variety outside of me nearly as well as I handle the infinite variety inside of me." Just as I was finishing graduate school, a church outside of Atlanta hired me to start a single adults group. I was highly ambitious at the time, but not all that healthy. The thing I wanted most in the world was for my new ministry to explode in number. I wanted young adults from around the city to flock to the community that I was building. So I started a Sunday night group with about 10 people, used my meager budget to hire a friend to play some music. I spent hours writing electric sermons that I thought would motivate people. And each week I invited everybody to come back again and bring a friend with you. Over time, that little group doubled in size and then tripled. And soon it had expanded to more than 10 times the size of our little starting core group. And that's about the time that Manny showed up. Manny's family had recently moved to Georgia from Mexico. They were poor and undocumented. His single mother spoke only broken English and was nobly raising Manny and his sister. The first time Manny attended our group, it was immediately apparent that he had some physical abnormalities, some mental limitations. Oh, but he loved coming to our group, making friends, singing songs, being independent in this world, if only just for an hour on Sunday nights. But there was a problem. Manny's condition meant he lacked impulse control. He struggled to read social cues. So as I would preach those electric sermons, Manny would blurt out a question, grinding everything to a halt, taking us down a rabbit trail. His outbursts became a recurring feature, and the rest of our group was growing annoyed. Then one week, a group of my head volunteers and regular attenders came to me, and they said Manny's participation in the group had become too disruptive and distracting. They were concerned that if he were allowed to keep coming, other people would stop coming. So, the next week I called Manny and his mom to the church. Coming to my office and through a translator, I explained the situation and said that I was sorry, but Manny could not come back to the group. His mom said she understood my rationale, and as I walked them out, I could see the heartbreak in his face. I wasn't in that role at that church much longer. But for the rest of my tenure there, a week did not pass that I wouldn't look at that empty chair in the front row where he always sat and feel like a total failure. You know, I'd gotten lost in the swirling cloud of my own ambition. I had forgotten that Manny and I, we belong to each other. Me to him and him to me. God chose to put us together. As Paul said, belonging to each other means caring for each other. And he held up his end of the bargain, and I and we did not. Truly, when one part suffers, the whole part suffers. And our community was worse off without Manny's light in our midst. He had so many things to teach me, to teach all of us, about courage and curiosity, gentleness and innocence, things that we humans could all use a little more of these days. You see, Manny didn't just need us, we needed him. Or as Paul says in verse 21, "The eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you. Nor again to the head, to the feet, I have no need of you. On the contrary, the parts of the body which seem to be weaker are indispensable." Sadly, too many faith communities have forgotten the deep wisdom the Apostle Paul was giving to the Corinthian church, that we belong to each other, and that the parts that we assume are the weakest are what make us the strongest. The parts we assume are the least needed are the most indispensable. They are to be honored the most. Oh, but all of this brings us back to where we started, I suppose. If the church is a people with whom we learn how to belong, why bother? There are lots of communities out there that at least promise acceptance. And belonging in a faith community seems to come with so many unique challenges, so why bother? Well, to answer this question, we go back to the beginning, as Paul says. For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. Scholars have long been confused by this. You expect Paul to say, so it is with the church. Paul isn't just saying that the church is like a body. He's saying that the church becomes the very essence of Christ. This is what the great mystics have referred to as divine union. What happens when we gather, not just gather with each other, but gather with each other in Christ's name? It doesn't happen when we gather in CrossFit's name. In this community, when we come together to care for each other, to suffer together, lifting up the weakest in honor, the presence of God presences among us, not just in our beliefs, but in the very fabric of our belonging. When you learn to accept your true self, you welcome the one who made you as you are. When you learn to love the other, whom you do not fully understand, you welcome the great other that you can never fully understand. When you suffer for the sake of the suffering, you encounter the one who suffered on your behalf. In Sufi mysticism, there's a proverb that goes like this. You think that because you understand one, you understand two, because one and one make two. But you must understand and. And you know who the and is, don't you? It's Christ, the one who is here among us, fashioning us together into a community of belonging, transforming I and me into a sacred we for the sake of the world. Amen.
And now that we've reflected on the gospel, we take a moment to declare our faith. This is the Apostles' Creed. We believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. We believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And now that we've declared our faith, we offer our prayers. These are the prayers of the people.
Please join us in the prayers of the people. Lord Jesus Christ, we pray for the church. For those of us who gather in this place and all who call Good Shepherd their church, all around the country and all around the world, let the distance that separates us geographically never become a distance in our spirits, but instead, please knit us together as we pray, sing, and confess, even across the miles. God of love, grant our prayer. Lord Jesus Christ, we pray for the world, this beautiful and wounded and delightful home that you've created. We thank you for the incomparable beauty of the created world, and we offer ourselves as stewards and caretakers, preserving its beauty and its diversity for future generations. God of love, grant our prayer. Lord Jesus Christ, we pray for the suffering among us. We hold before you both the joy and the terror of being alive in this world, the wounds and bruises that mark each one of us. We pray for healing, hope, and comfort. both as we suffer and as we celebrate. God of love, grant our prayer. Lord Jesus Christ, we pray for those we have loved who are no longer with us. We grieve the caverns in our hearts left by their absence, and we ask for you and your love to stitch us back together day by day as we mourn. God of love, grant our prayer.
Now that we've prayed our prayers, we make space for confession. Confession is simply owning and naming the ways in which we fall short of love. Love for our Creator, love for ourselves, love for our neighbor. And so right now, we invite you into this act of holy memory, asking for the help of God's Spirit to focus in on a memory that matters. And as we do this, we do so with an awareness of the message and the life of Jesus, the God that was revealed there, a God who is kind and tender and warm and compassionate and includes us with all of our complexities and with all of our sin. And so in the light of that love, we enter into this introspection and we ask for God's help. And so right now, as best as you know how, simply think of the week behind and allow a memory to come to the surface. And as that memory comes to the surface, simply take responsibility for it. Feel yourself pivot away from it. Ask for God's help to imagine a different way forward. Let's do this together. As our memories are coming and rising to the surface of our minds, I invite you with every breath to inhale the love of God and the tenderness, the kindness of God, the patience of God, and to exhale all of those anxieties, those burdens, the barriers that we carry with us, typically rooted in a vision of God who is vindictive, full of vengeance, and even perhaps cold and aloof. I know that you're not alone as these memories are coming to our minds and we feel ourselves taking responsibility and seeking to move away what the Bible calls repent, that we're not alone. And so we enter into this corporate confession together. Would you join me in this? Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We've not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we would delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. And now, dear friends, hear the good news of Jesus Christ, that as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is God's love toward you. As far as the east is from the west, so far has God removed our transgressions from us. You are loved, you are forgiven, you are included, and you are free in Jesus Christ. Amen. And now we come to the meal that Jesus gave us, what we call Holy Communion or Eucharist. And in this meal, we remember and we encounter the grace of God and the power of God in our lives. And so we begin with this beautiful ancient prayer. Would you join me in this? The Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. God, it is a good and joyous thing to say thank you. And right now we consider together the good gifts of our lives. And as we allow our hearts to attach to those gifts, we channel them into praise, which we sense rising, joining the voices of the angels and the archangels of Isaiah's vision, where they say and sing, "Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are filled with your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." And now we pray that by the power of your Holy Spirit, according to your word, that these gifts of bread and cup would become to us and for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who on the night he was betrayed, took bread and cup and blessed them. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread. And after he blessed it, he gave it to his disciples and he said, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And so we welcome you, risen Christ. We thank you for this body that is broken and given, a sign of your love and of your commitment to heal and to save our world. We pray that you would grace us as we receive your love afresh, as we receive the bread. And may we likewise be broken and given as a gift for our world in love. Amen. Likewise, Jesus took the cup, and after he blessed it, gave it to his disciples and said, "This cup is the cup of a new covenant in my blood, shed for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." And so we welcome you, risen Christ. We thank you for this cup, which speaks a better word than our vengeance, than our retaliation and violence, than our grudges and our bitterness, than our inability to push forward into peace. It points us instead to the way of Jesus Christ, the God revealed there, one that forgives our debts, that sets us free, that moves us toward reconciliation and restitution, that heals our hearts and our world. Amen. And now, friends, we declare the mystery of faith. Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ has risen, Christ will come again. And these are God's holy gifts for God's holy people. Jesus Christ is holy, Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God. Amen. And now, friends, we receive Holy Communion together. Our practice is intinction, where we take the bread and dip it in the cup. But those of you who have the elements in your homes around the country, around the world, you can receive and partake as you see fit. We also want you to know that we practice an open table, which means any drawn to the love that we see in Christ are welcome to receive the bread and the cup. And we simply ask you to let this be a gesture of your open heart toward the love that you find there. And one final reminder, as we feast in Holy Communion, we celebrate this union we have, this solidarity that we have with one another and with all humanity. And we open our hearts to receive the grace to live into that this week. Let's celebrate Holy Communion together. Thanks be to God.
And now receive this benediction, which comes from Tokopa Turner's book, Belonging, Remembering Ourselves Home. For the rebels and the misfits, the black sheep and the outsiders. For the refugees, the orphans, the scapegoats, and the weirdos. For the uprooted, the abandoned, the shunned, and the invisible ones. May you recognize in increasing vividness that you know what you know. May you give up your allegiances to self-doubt, meekness, and hesitation. May you be willing to be unlikable, and in the process be utterly loved. May you be impervious to the wrongful projections of others, and may you deliver your disagreements with precision and grace. May you see with the consummate clarity of nature moving through you that your voice is not only necessary but desperately needed to sing us out of this muddle. May you feel shored up, supported, entwined, and reassured as you offer yourself and your gifts to the world. And may you know for certain that even as you stand by yourself, you are not alone. Go in peace.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise God, all creatures here below. Praise God above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Go in peace.
Love you, but long as there are stars above you, you never need to doubt it. I'll make you so sure about it. God only knows what I'd be without you. If you should ever leave me, the life would still go on, believe me. The world could show nothing to me. So what good would living do me? God only knows what I'd be without you.
God only knows what I'd be without you.